Japan, a land of mystery. For hundreds of years, the secrets of the Far East have baffled minds across the world. What is that man doing? Nobody knows. What is that? Amazing. This, unexplainable. Okay, okay. Japan may not be that surprising to most of you anymore.
Some of you who have watched my previous video know that I left Japan when I was 15 and then came back when I was 26. So when I came back to Japan, I realized there were so many strange cultures and norms in this country.
So today, I'm going to share with you the top 7 things that even surprised me about Japan.
So here comes first one.
Japanese people will always shout at you. Imagine the following. You are out in town for a calm, relaxing night. Time to grab something to eat, maybe something to drink. You walk into the bar.
Yes, yes, sir!
So when you go to izakaya, people are loud. But when I talk about people, I'm not talking about customers. I'm talking about staff who are loud. So reason behind it is that the louder you are, the more welcoming you can be. And also, the being loud voice actually shows the freshness of the food they serve. In some Japanese restaurants, especially in the izakaya, you get trained to be loud. Like your boss always like train you every day. Before they open a restaurant, they go like, Yashimase! 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 Yeah, you might be actually seeing that in some Japanese documentary or programs. I'm gonna teach you some shouting words just in case you hear it so you don't get surprised. First one, Yashimase! Welcome! That's, you hear this every time you go into these izakayas, right? Second one, thank you. Instead of arigatou gozaimasu, it's a polite way, right? Arigatou! Arigatou! It's a short word.
I can't even like tell that's from arigatou gozaimasu. So
third one, my pleasure. Whenever you all try to order something, they might reply with this word. Yorokonde! Yorokonde! And lastly, whenever you ask for a bill, somehow these places have to tell everyone that you are leaving. Okesama okaeri desu!
I don't know why you have to say that, but everyone says that.
So whenever you hear these in the words, I don't know when you can use this, but when you hear it, that's what they're saying. So now you're used to Japanese people shouting.
Next!
Number 2. Japanese dating is a team effort. Have you ever wondered how to pick up women in Japan? Lift with your legs, not your back.
So in Japan, people don't really go to bars and pick up people. It just needs so much of bravery for us to go up to someone that you don't know and just start talking to them.
In fact, most Japanese izakayas aren't set up in a way where you can interact with anyone but the people you came with. A lot of time, you'll be in a separate room known as koshitsu, with a door that closes, so you can't even see the other customers. So, how do young people meet?
We invented something that gets past this, which is called gokon. So to cut the long story short, the gokon is an organized pickup dating party, let's put it that way. So there are two coordinators, one male, one female. The female will bring 4 friends, and male bring 4 other friends and meet them up in izakaya or one party place. So you just kind of get seated and wait for these coordinators to introduce you to the others. So that's how we meet.
But what if you don't have a group of friends or colleagues to invite you to a gokon? Don't worry, Japan has this covered too. There's a special type of bar called aisekiya. These are izakayas where you and your friends will be assigned to a group of strangers to sit across from. And the idea is, you can now start up a conversation and meet someone.
Oh, by the way, the girls are free food and drinks.
And what if you don't like the person sitting across from you? Get up and get another drink, secretly gesture to the waiter, and they'll tell you it's time to change your table.
So in Japan, even dating with someone, it's like team sport.
Number 3. Everyone in Japan parks in reverse.
So when you come to Japan, you might notice that everyone is parking reverse everywhere. There's a reason behind this. Japan is almost like a smorgasbord of natural disasters. So we have typhoons, tornadoes, flooding, tsunami, earthquakes, and volcano. Every time one of these occurs, we have to evacuate or escape as soon as possible. It's quite a scenery when you go to a countryside to like a mega supermarket where like hundreds of cars, like every single one of them is parking backwards. So if you are planning to drive in Japan, make sure to practice parking backwards very well beforehand.
In fact, it's so common to park in reverse in Japan that often people won't be looking out for cars reversing out of the parking spaces here. So be extra careful of accidents. On a totally unrelated note, it's much easier to escape if you hit someone with your car when you've reverse parked. Just a fun fact. Number 4. Not all noodles are equal. I bet when you guys come to Japan, one of the first things you eat is ramen. Delicious, steamy, flavorful, perfect on a cold day. But don't forget about udon or soba. You guys need to try this too. Maybe you're visiting Fukuoka and you say, "Hey, I'd like to try some soba." Everyone looks at you. What the f*** did you just say, you little shit? Okay, maybe not that drastic, but you may be surprised to know
you find udon better in the West and soba in the East.
Historically, this is because of the different climates in East and West of Japan. Buckwheat, used to make soba, is crop that can be grown in the colder prefectures, perfect for places like Yamagata or Nagano that get a lot of snow. And wheat for udon is best to be grown in the warmer climates with lots of sun, like Kyushu, for example. This evolved into different regions of Japan taking pride in their homegrown noodles, with even a broth made for soba having a very different taste in the East, where it will be much stronger compared to the West.
So when you visit Osaka, Kyoto, and Fukuoka in the West, make sure to try their udon, they're really good. But when you're in the East, such as Tokyo or Sendai, especially when you're in Morioka City in Iwate Prefecture, make sure to do the Wanko Soba All You Can Eat Challenge.
Hey, enjoying the video? Having a good, relaxing time? I have a secret to tell you. Come closer. It's time for the return of Ryotaro's shopping channel.
Instead of like boring shadow games or VPN sponsorships, I wanted to show you some made in Japan real stuff. Made in Japan things that are made by real Japanese people. And today, I want to show you this.
Today, we have this lovely denim kimono. Made by some of my friends, actually. This denim kimono is perfect for those who love Japan and love style. Kimonos are usually quite bulky and very hard to put on, but this kimono was made so that anyone can enjoy wearing one. It's super easy to put on. Just click the buttons and done. They also come with their own stylish obi belt designs, such as this lovely cloud pattern, traditional Japanese art, cat. But don't think you can pull off wearing a kimono every day? Well, no fear. It can also be worn as this stylish long denim coat. Perfect for standing awkwardly in the middle of the street posing for photos. Since these are made with denim as well, they'll gradually age and gain character just like a quality pair of jeans, and they're all machine washable. So, don't miss out. There is only limited stock. Also, as a special gift to you, I'll pick one lucky buyer to receive a free kimono coat that I'm wearing in this video.
So if you want your own denim outer kimono, check the description box below for the special discount, and you can look as good as me.
Number 5. Japanese people love adapting? Middle-aged men.
Did you know that Japan has got one of the highest adoption rate in the whole world? And they are mainly adults.
Now you may be asking yourself, why should I adopt a balding middle-aged Japanese man? There are many reasons. You can take them with you to the cinema, so you're not alone. They can teach you how to play Japanese chess. You can ask them to look after your stuff when you go to the bathroom. So useful. But that's not the real reason this happens in Japan. When you're a rich, successful businessman or woman, the more heirs you have, the less you need to pay inheritance tax. In fact, this happens so often here in Japan, the government had to place restrictions on the amount of people you could adopt for tax purposes in the 80s. This didn't stop people adopting as many tax-friendly adults as they could though. In 2011, for example, over 81,000 people were adopted in Japan, and 90% of those are adults. Historically, this also happened during the samurai period, where strong samurai clans would adopt suitable leaders to run things if they didn't have a son, or if they thought their own children wouldn't be up to the job. Wow, thanks for the vote of confidence, Dad. I hate this family.
By the way, my brother has only 2 daughters. So if you're a successful businessman, please comment down below with the credit card details and he might adopt you.
Number 6. Use salt to scare away ghosts. There's something strange in a neighborhood. Who you gonna call? No one. Just use salt. In Shintoism, salt is used to purify sacred places and cast away evil or harmful spirits. Also, it's very common in Japan to see small plates of salt outside of rooms or even stores and restaurants. These are called morishio, and it's believed that by placing these, evil spirits can't enter your house or business and do evil spirit stuff, like steal shit from the fridge or something.
Salt is often used to purify sacred places. You must have seen sumo wrestlers sprinkling salt. They're doing it to purify the ring before their match.
If you ever go to a funeral as well, you may even receive a salt after the service, so you can make sure no spirits follow you back by sprinkling it over yourself.
So if you have someone you hate, who you don't want to enter your room or house, make sure to have two amounts of salt left and right and chuck it at him. And I think that's what I'm going to do next time I see Chris.
Oh my lord.
Number 7. Why Japan has so much weird shit? The 80s in Japan were wild time. The economy was booming, electronics were starting to take off and take the world by storm. And we also invented this plumber so they could eventually be voiced by Chris Pratt in the future. There was a lot of money to go around, and in the late 80s, the Prime Minister at the time, Noboru Takeshita, had a great idea to give over 3,000 local governments over 100 million yen, maybe close to $1 million with inflation, to do whatever they want. This project was called Furusato Sosei, or Hometown Development, created with the idea of revitalizing local municipalities with new and exciting buildings or events. The city of Date in Fukushima decided to spend the money on a public bathroom with a self-playing piano. Oirase in Aomori Prefecture decided to build a replica of the Statue of Liberty. Yamagata City decided to make Japan's biggest pot so they could cook their traditional imoni, or beef and taro root stew. The town of Tabayama decided to make Japan's longest slide, and 3 years later, another town made a bigger slide. The town of Nakatosa in Kochi Prefecture decided to make a solid gold fish, which was later stolen and melted down and sold. The town of Shinto in Guma decided to put their money into a savings account and got an extra 60 million yen from 15 years of interest, which is probably the smartest thing any of the towns did. And Tsugaru in Aomori made this thing. Lots of towns also spent the money on things like buying fireworks for festivals or holding big events. And many of these relics of this project still exist to this day in random parts of the countryside.
After all this, one politician asked Prime Minister Takeshita, "Wasn't that a waste of money?" And he replied, "Now we know which governments were the clever ones." When you come to Japan, those statues and buildings are still here, so try to find them. And remember, it's not Japanese people who are weird, it's just local governments.
So there you have it, the 7 most surprising things about Japan.
Tell me what surprised you the most in the video, and also tell me if there are other things that surprised you while you're in Japan. Leave me a comment and surprise me, and I'll see you in the next video.